Along this, we said, well, of course, the urban green line in this part, along this park of Centocelle, goes underground. Here it is the underground discovery of the thing. So basically, what has been done here, the tramway goes underneath, but at the same time it generates a museum of the tram and the tram stops that are all there. So basically, in this part, the tramway runs underneath and it creates a tram stop, and at the same time it creates a museum of the tram, because Rome actually was the city that has more tram in all Europe. Mussolini take them out because they were kind of left, you know, he preferred to have tanks going around the streets in parades than trams. This you understand very, very briefly how certain technology that everybody knows we use. For example, here was the issue how you recreate a kind of continuity on the park. So automatic cellular data technology was developed to do that. And here there are other modifier and transformers and things that you do it very well, you do it every day, that allows to shape this underground cave-like architecture, or if you want to call vie cave-like architecture, almost 3,000 years after. So you understand a little bit why all these things are for us a material of thinking in a rather complex way. Now I'll show instead a project, again on the urban green line, that has to do more with the implementation of technology. When we all work around the idea of the crisis, we want to use information technology, using it not as an embellishment for a rich person in his villa to play with his friend interactive games, but really in order to tackle real crisis in real environment. My student, after lots of work together, etc., you can imagine, they were very alerted. In a certain moment, discovered this technology in Japan. Some researcher copyrighted this technology. The technology transform sound into energy, capture noise, and the noise becomes a form of energy that can create energy. We are all used of piezoelectric technology. In that case, it's movement that creates energy. In this case, it's more interesting because it's the sound, it's the noise that actually can be activate a system of energy. So what you see here, you see a very interesting process. The tram, in some way, makes a little noise, as we can see. This noise can be tackled and through movable and changeable interactive sound barriers that in some way are within the system because they don't use any other energy than the sound of the tram itself. So these technologies are one of those thinking that you think systematically about a certain issues. And of course, as you can see that, then you can use scripting technology and modifiers and so on and so forth to organize this matter within our time, technology, but I will also say our vision of the world. This is another project, another systematic project that again will show this way of thinking. I will finish in 10 minutes maximum. In this case, what we see is another process. The urban green line makes a 13 kilometers ring. That means it goes in some part of the city that is extremely polluted and very high dense, and in other parts along the park, for example, much lower density. The idea is, it is that in those parts at a lower density, you create degli stagni, that means some water ponds, in which there is a specific alga as a name, alga stalgamina, I don't remember how. This specific alga has the capability to create oxygen in a like 20 or 30 times more than a normal chlorophyllian process. So the tram passing along these ponds capture this all extra oxygen, and since it's a systematic thing, what it does, it releases this oxygen when it goes close to these canopies. The canopies, of course, are in the higher dense, higher polluted part of the city. So along these are not just canopies, beautiful or less beautiful, useful or not useful. Of course, there are many other things, but mainly they are accumulator of oxygen, and the oxygen is released when it is needed. So this is one of the many other examples that I can show to exactly tell you why this is those five things that I described before. So this is not the tram in terms of, you know, only a means of transportation. The tram activates many things, activates projects, activates the situation, is within a system. After my visit last year of the Mercedes headquarters in Stuttgart by UN Studio, I was really extremely impressed by the importance of this architecture. And although I edit this book that it is just out in the English version, Digital Warbeckel, and 10 years ago, as an editor of a monographs book series, I edit the book Ben Van Berkel by a very good writer, Antonello Marotta, and this one also is very good, Andrea Sollazzo, a very, very old student of mine. But I really didn't really completely understood the incredible power and complex systematic thinking that was behind that building since I really saw it in action. I really needed to saw it in actions. And so from that point on, in many occasions in my teaching, I was really kind of push the student in thinking in some terms of that systematic thinking in terms of actual architectural. This is a one case. We are talking about a graduation work, while these are coursework. In this case, the tram has to overpass a railway is on the only place where the tram has to do that for a series of reasons that I will not tell. Along this area is a very complex studies of diagrams and forces that take place there, and particularly they burn at least three projects. One is this one along here, one in this one, and another one is going to burn like right now along this area that is not, is still in progress now. So all these projects, I have a systematic thinking. This is all the thinking behind the Urban Green Line. They are part of the Urban Green Line because the Urban Green Line runs along here more exactly. And at the same time, the architecture is born together with the Urban Green Line. In this case, it's not a systematic action, it is something that is really built in. So this is one project, I will not go into it, but I can go a little bit into this, and you understand that basically this is a school of new, with a new pedagogy, is a school that is based on a series of processes that are not developed now in Italy. The tram passed through, and at the same time, all the architecture has to be a very complex interconnected system in order to go with it. this is just one of the many effort that we do on that. So, well, we always, at this moment, again, in a certain moment, I was thinking of this guy, of course, at the Mercedes-Benz, and I will try to refer back to what I said. I was looking at what we used to be, I used to be often diagrams, but probably it's not better to call rings or better magic rings. I was starting to think in this moment. And then in some way I have to prove that idea of the magic crisis. Really, that idea of the magic crisis that was so difficult to say why we deal with that magic crisis, and that and the action of involved with a creative process, either in art or in architecture or in other matters, has to do with that moment. There is a crisis and there is the capability to overcome that crisis. So what can be a bigger crisis than the death of this Raffaello? Raffaello is a semi-dead, he's a semi-god. Is now the closest thing of God that we have is Google. I often play with that. I use all the categories of God applying to Google, and almost all apply. So Google is not God, but is very close to God. Is everywhere, it knows everywhere, is super rich, etc., etc. We make things with that. But before Google, is sure that Raffaello is pretty close to that. So this is Latin. And Latin is really the most wonderful language that was ever invented, because it has such a strength. And what this phrase says in the logic of Latin, it is just incredible. So I had a translation in Italy, in German, and in English of this magic crisis that is a circle. Is a circle that closes itself around this crisis and move farther. Read it, and we're done. Thank you. Well, are around, I would say, what we published in the ARCA are around 25, around a number, well, in terms of design thesis are around 20, and around project of IT we called are around 150. So what is published is around 10% of a base around 100, at least 100.
So, long and wonderful journey that you took us on. It basically ends with the urban green line as a sort of manifestation, if not even a contemporary manifesto. And I think you have five principal characteristics of that, of the urban green line. And I'm just wondering, on a quite practical level, how you maintain those interests in that number of projects that are being undertaken. Are those, by the way, also established before?
They are established before.
They are established before.
How do I? It is interesting that this question. Technically, so we are talking technically in terms of. Actual teaching. The Urban Green Line, technically speaking, it is the final project of a course that is called Information Technology Revolution in Architecture. The base of this course is to open the student to an understanding that there is a very strong relationship between the architectural debate and the use of certain technology and certain media. So they follow exercise to understand this, and at the same time they are exposed to the theory behind a certain architectural search and a certain technology at the same time. So the whole course is built like that. At a certain moment, at one third of the course, the ear team it is presented, and the ear team it is Urban Green Line, and they are activated also in thinking in this direction. And the lecture are very important for my strategy, because the student get motivated to the complexity of the issue with the system of the lecture, basically, and with kind of structure like this one, thinking structure and action structure. And then there is a little bit like in a studio, some process of dialogue, we call revision in Italian, so there is a descript, what we may call in English, of course there are descripts in order to develop the project. But basically the whole work of the Urban Green Line is one semester work, and it ends with a public presentation in a kind of conference format. Then the student, some just 5% or 10% of that course go on in graduation. So in graduation they bring the issue to a further level, and generally they transform what can be a very strong, nice idea, some that we've seen, but they are not really architecture. I mean, what we see, I don't know, here or here, these are more concept type of architecture. It's not really an architectural design. They transform in an architectural design project to be defended in thesis. So that's the system. What I wanted to underline is normally in academia, in Italy particularly, student work is considered an independent, pretty much an independent academic exercise, and generally the publication as paid by the state for some type of funding, and generally this publication remains on shelters, you know, that is the typical trend. So in this case, what is very, very important from my point of view is that all this work has been thought from the very beginning as a contribution to the city, to the cultural debate and to the work, etc. There is no main basic mention here that this is an architectural student or graduate work. It is a cultural contribution that arrives to an international magazine. We may love Larca or don't, but it's an international magazine. And it has been translated completely in English, etc. So that's the system, technically speaking. Yes, please aloud. In Italian it's better.
You showed pictures of the Chirico and Rossi.
Yeah.
And then this Etruscan monuments in the rocks. And they have something in common. It's about movement in
No, in my case, why I use the Chirico, they may have an interconnection, of course, but in my particular case, I needed to create very clear categories in this particular type of lecture and organization. So while I was using the Chirico and Rossi, was strictly to say that idea of architecture as an artificial object, a place in an abstract space, and that generally dominates nature, that is the idea that comes from the Roman military camp. Centuries after centuries, still was there, and is not a case that that idea in some way was represented in some way by the Chirico, and then actionized by thing. Now, so that is my structure. Then if we can start to, you know, to move things around, which is very interesting. Well, I didn't notice the sky, for example, in this De Chirico thing. We can start to build another story. Why not? We can start to build another story. But that was my story. I use it within this context.
Yeah.
They don't relate to the Etruscan at all. In my point of view, they don't relate to the Etruscan at all. That's why they belong to this chapter. North military grid abstraction plan Roman is a completely different. You see, it's over here. That is over. So that is a cycle that is over there. It stops. This is another chapter. Yeah, that's another chapter. So from my construction, those they don't relate.
Mm-hmm. Which maybe claim that they mark the movement, they are kind of markers of this movement, or even kind of related to time. And in your Greenland project, also especially the one in the cave, you also have kind of sections which mark, which are perpendicular to the axis of movement. So I want to ask about, is it intentional? And
I think this is a typical ingredients that you start thinking diagonally out of a thing that I was thinking in a certain way, which is completely great for architects. I will tell you something more. The Pantheon is built like this too. You know, it's a system of arcade similar to the Colosseum. So we may start to merge things and to have another creative solution, and that is how you do research, you do new projects, and you do new things. I was not thinking at all along this line, but we can start to think about it, why not? And then we'll see where it brings. But I was not thinking along those lines, but OR there could be rather interesting. Yeah.
Antonio, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.